asked to say a few words about Rusty, who got locked up about nearly 4 weeks ago now. We just got a letter through the post here today. It's a general civil restraint order. A general civil restraint order.
This is in relation to Rusty, by the way.
Right. It's a general civil restraint order, as I was saying, yeah. And what it consists of, really, is that he's on a Judge Pellin QC, who I like to name and shame officially here on camera now, has made an order here gagging Rusty for the next 2 years. And what he's actually saying is that any judicial reviews, any appeals, anything at all that goes in, including an appeal against the order that he's made, that he has to go back to this judge and ask for his permission to put it in, and then he decides whether he can put it in or he can't put it in. Effectively, like the judge like said, right, I'm doing this to you.
And it, process,
yeah,
then.
Yeah, and yeah. If you want to appeal against it, come back and see me and I'll consider it. This is exactly what they're saying. He's in court on Friday. Is that the 7th?
It's the 7th. Passed the vexatious.
Sorry?
Have they classed him as a vexatious litigant?
No. Well, he can't, because on everyone he met, judicial review was without vexation. He put it on every single one of them, so I've come there. If they've accepted it as being what it is, they have to accept what's in it as well. It just summarily just squashed everything, every review, everything. And what they did as well about, because Rusty went out on TNS Live saying that he would not surrender to any court but an High Court,
in common law,
and they tricked him into thinking this was common law court. So he went in there and then just threw him to the police afterwards. They took him away because he'd already been convicted by trial, by jury, in his absence, with no defence. He defended himself, yeah? So the only way they could have tried him is if they elected a defence from them on his behalf to try him and to find him guilty.
Heresy.
Yeah. So, and the reason he's locked up now is he's a convicted prisoner. Yeah. He's not on remand. He's a convicted prisoner from what they've done, this trial that they had in his absence. Well, he had the judicial reviews, and he think, well, judicial review takes it to an higher court. So they put that, wrote the letters. Can you wait? They didn't. They just went ahead with it. Yeah. And then this judge has gone. His judicial review and gone, nah, I don't think this is good enough. And just threw it out and then just threw him to the place. He went in there and in court on that Thursday, he went in there and no less than four times, he rebutted that the judge he was sitting there was executor. Yeah? He put him on notice, he's a public servant, he's a trustee.
Yeah?
He went in there as executor and he went in there as beneficiary, therefore stopping the CPS as being beneficiary for dragging you there. And he told him, he said, yeah, no less than four times he told him, and twice he asked for a sheriff to arrest the judge, yeah, because this is what we said we should do. After what happened at Birkenhead, because we were bad people at Birkenhead, we shouldn't do that, yeah? So after we did it at Birkenhead, he said, well, no, this is how you should do it. You should ask a sheriff, and if you think the judge is doing something, I'll have him arrested, yeah? The judge never rebutted once that he was acting as trustee. So when he was operating outside the remit as a trustee that day, yeah, then we asked twice for the sheriff to be brought and the rest of the judges, and nothing happened at all. What happened?
Did,
yeah, as far as I'm concerned, and anyone else who was there who were watching it, it doesn't matter what you say, it doesn't matter if you rebut it. Yeah? They said there's these 12 presumptions that the courts have, and they presume that they're the executors, that they're above you, and they can. To get it's all about, and this is what we're doing now, what we're talking about next on, we're down with the People's Public Trust, right? We have to go into court. We have to make them toe the line. We have to put the notice on them and say, you're in public office, you're a trustee. You're not there, you're not in public office, yeah, to play high and mighty over me. Yeah, you work for us, you're public servants. Yeah? And we have to put them on notice and tell them that's what they are, the public servants, no more, nothing else, nothing less. That's what your job is, that's what you get paid for, do your job. It'll be the same quote that at Birkenhead, do your job to the police. All public servants, your quotes there now, do your job, because that is it. That's all I've got to say. And I'm not working out, but Darren's coming on next, and the people, public trust, right, is if they, and we're going in there, and we're getting badges made up, yeah, and we're going in there as court observers, we're taking the clipboards in, everything, and we will sit in judgment of them sitting in judgment on us.
Yeah. Just to say, what was the judge's name again? So we
Pelling, QC Pelling. It says he is sitting as an High Court judge. Now, whether he is or not, I don't know. Maybe he's just practicing for it. But whether he is, he didn't really, you know, he just ignored everything. But the main thing is if you make a statement in the court of law, yeah, it's down to them. And if they're using presumptions and we're denying them presumptions and assumptions, yeah, and then we put them on notice that we've denied them presumptions and assumptions, yeah, and then they just carry on ignoring you and presuming that they're there as executors, then they're operating outside. They are not. The trustees, yeah? The trustees of the trust, yeah? They're operating outside their remit and they're operating unlawfully.
Sorry, Loki. Sorry to interrupt, but if the judge is, or the alleged judge is saying he is sitting as judge, I'm pretty sure that means that he's not a judge, he is a high sheriff. When you're calling for the sheriff, he's already sitting there.
Well, I'm not sure. We were told by the clerk is that there is no such things as sheriffs in courts anymore. They don't have them in courts anymore. And when we looked up the High Sheriff of Manchester, there was some woman, and all she was trustee to the police trust. Join in the High Court High Sheriff of Manchester is like to the police trust of the police trust. Yeah, the actual High Sheriff's job is like to just dress somebody up like a Lord Mayor now and parade them out in front of people.
But the High Sheriff still has all those powers that
I don't. I think that any power, anybody that had any power over them in any office, they've turned it into a joke job. A joke position.
Mascot.
Exactly. But no. It ain't had the power. It's been emancipated. It ain't got the power no more.
I suppose
it's been buried in statute and it's gone with the rest of the common law. Just bury it all in statute so you can't find
it. The judge is acting as executive assenteur.
Well, this is what I'm saying with the people's public trust, what Darren's going to speak about now. If we can get into court, this is what we need to put them back to say, listen, this is your job, and it's not just the courts.
Councils
who sound privatising everything off and subcontracting to firms. They're siphoning public money off into private enterprises and they're filling their own pockets. Yeah, they were that cocky about it a couple of years ago. The government got caught with the hand in the cookie jar. They have to come out. Everyone else, all the other cookie jars are still going. Yeah, and this is what we need. We need to put people, just remind them what they are. I'm talking about the DHSS, exactly the same. When we make a claim, we're making a claim, we're suing UK Corporation for not getting us a job. Yeah, that's why we're called the beneficiaries, that's why we get benefits. All these trustees are, in the shop, like I said, the trustees administering the trust, giving it out. So when the trustees start threatening you, if you don't do this, we're going to stop your benefits, that's a breach of trust. That's what they've done, breach of trust. It's a major breach of trust. Trustees don't threaten beneficiaries. What sort of a trust is that?
Especially when
every letter you get off them is designed as a threat, as intimidation. These public servants, that's a joke. These public servants have got to work for themselves. And to be honest, it's not them in particular because they don't know what they're doing. They're just giving these prepared notes and papers and everything. Oh, and another thing we've just learnt, and it might be anyone who's doing any court things or court costs and that, I've got it from Mike Dobson, so it's good for them. If you're going in and you're putting any court papers in, plagiarise their papers because they can only charge you if it's on their papers, but they can't deny you if you've got the same thing more or less on a film and put it in and it's set out in that way. So the only way they can charge you.
So what you're saying then is if you scan the form and take all the font formatting that they've used and the board.
You've got anything going that far. Check their thing off it, put yours on it. Put your emblem on it.
So you're not paying for their paperwork, you've just created your own.
Exactly. As long as you're the key questions and the key and the statements, how they goes on to that. As long as you're not using their forms, they have to accept it, yeah, and they can't charge you because it's not on their forms, because that's all they charge the administration for, is for using their forms.
Cool. Thanks, mate.
Suddenly all shift their focus and turn your way and like, whoa, okay. Good evening, everybody. First of all, I'm Darren, for those of you that don't know. I've been doing this stuff for a few years, helping people out, doing different things. I'll talk a little bit about where I'm kind of up to in a bit. But I just wanted to see, does everybody kind of understand what Loki was going on about when he was talking about the concept of trusts and then being the trustee and things like that?
Vaguely. Do you want to go straight from the beginning?
Well, I just wanted to see what everybody was up to, because obviously people have come here with from all sorts of different backgrounds and positions, and many using many, many different approaches. So I just wanted to see sort of how many were on this sort of trust gig, as it were. So not that many?
No.
Okay. Sorry?
That's right, we're here, isn't it?
Well, we all know there's three positions, don't we? Trustee, beneficiary and executor. Yeah. We're all aware of that.
I think in terms of all of this, I think let's cut right to the chase. And I think the question I want to pose straight away is, what is it you actually want out of whatever method or approach or research that you're actually doing? What is your actual objective? What would you name it for just now?
Gaining respect from authorities.
You want respect from authorities?
Yeah. Okay. We want them to do the job.
Looking for?
Gaining knowledge.
You're good in it for the knowledge. Yeah. But what's the goal of the knowledge? Where do you want to take
that's
you?
That's what I'd like to know, and that's what I'd... That's a big picture, I suppose.
Yeah, okay. Anyone else?
Freedom.
Yeah,
man.
Yeah.
Plans of seed for the future.
Yeah.
Freedom from monetary enslavement.
Equality.
Sustainability.
Pass it on to your family.
Yeah. And you wonder what you want to leave for your family is of safe and of a decent quality, and you know, it's worth being in, don't you? So this is where I'm coming at it from as well. Now, what I've wasted my time on many a notice, on many a challenge, on many a day travelling to court to help somebody out and all the rest of it. And I'm a bit tired of it, to be quite honest, after a few years of it. I don't know how long many of you have been at it. And yes, there's a lot of fun to be had, you know, especially when you first get into it and you get a sense of your own authority and your own empowerment and the right of your opinion and the right of your position, however you may find it, you know, that's all very empowering at first. But the thrill wears off after many, many, many blank responses. You know, I think many of us felt that when we went into this, that if you came at it with good intent and with an authentic position and all the rest of it, that you would have some kind of healthy dialogue or an effective interface of some kind, because that was what I was looking for. You know, I was looking for some kind of connection at the other end, some kind of human interface, and all I seemed to get was standard letters in response. And I'd be like, come on, I spent bloody hours on that. That was brilliant. I stitched you up, mate. You were done. You were had. You know, and that's it. And I've walked away many a time with that feeling, you know, and I'm sure many of you have. Because this really is what it is about. It's about your empowerment. It's about you realising that actually your authority was never stolen from you. It was never taken from you. It was assumed away. You just assumed it away, just through your conduct, just through the way that we behave, our acquiescence to things, our everyday behaviour, we assumed it away. Now, the thing that what you're finding out now is that we're all researching this in our different ways and approaching it in different ways and finding out where the authority does lie, and, you know, at the other end, really, there isn't some grand overarching conspiracy with the people that you deal with on a day-to-day basis. That's for sure, they're just people doing a job as well. You know, and so, really, the question for me is, for everybody really, is, well, do you want to keep playing that game and playing touche and all the rest of it, or do you want to actually start to change something and have an effect? Because my thing is, what I'm interested in is an effective interface. I know many people aren't going to be interested in my position. I'm interested in many other people's positions. We all have our own lives and what we want from it and all the rest of it, and that's what privacy is, that's what private means. That's part of what's been taken away from us. But really, other than that, when we are interfacing with our paid servants, our hired employees who are meant to represent our well-being and our interests and our progress and our safety, this is obviously what they're imbued with, then, you know, you want that to be effective. And I'm sure what many of you are learning is that it's not really. And people went rusty that Loki's just been talking about, so I'm going to have to steal a drink. You know, how many people here actually know Rusty personally? Okay, there's only a few of you. I'll tell you something about that character, because he's done nothing but go out of his way to help people in the last year and a half or so. And he's such an incredible character because you would never think of it to meet him. He's the most down-to-earth, working-class lad there ever was. He learned to read and write through this stuff, you know, with quite a raucous and rough background. But he is such a diamond, where his heart is completely in the right place. And what has happened to him is a bit of a travesty, but it's easy to see how people can interpret some of his actions in a particular way. And obviously there's people working to help out in that. But I just want to mention him as an example, because through this movement and through this desire for an effective interface, our friends are, you know, in jail. And, you know, some of them lost their houses. Some of them are being chased with bailiffs and lots of things going on, and they're having to call people in to, you know, protect them. Now, that's not really very effective, is it? You know, that's not my idea of an effective interface from them, so I'm sure that's what I'm tired of, is this shouldn't be happening. You know, especially when people have a lawful position. Now, the concept that I kind of developed over the last couple of years was, it was quite funny because it first looked like it was an organisation that was being created, but I've since learned it wasn't that at all. So, I suppose I'd like to backtrack a little bit here. So I've been talking, I do my own event before I found out about all this stuff. This stuff was a bit of a sideline for me. I got into this through the language side of it, and I've been doing a lot on, I do self-development events on perception, gender, language, things about getting in touch with our environment and ourselves. And I got into this because of the power of the language side of it. But for years I've been going on about the corporate enslavement of humanity being something that has stared us in the face for a very, very long time. And it's not something that's conspiratorial, it's something that's literally looking at us. So for those of you that have seen me before, I'm sorry, you've probably heard this, I'll have to repeat it. But, you know, 6 or 7 years ago when I was talking to people about this, and, you know, you will probably know that folk would be saying, oh, it's all very conspiratorial, what do you mean, corporate enslavement of humanity, what do you mean, this dark agenda, or whatever. And I'd be like, well, a conspiracy implies something that's hidden. And actually what's in front of us is staring us in the face. And I would say, well, just look at the attire a man has to wear to go to work in the city every day. And I want you all to picture that, picture the attire of the suit. And what do we call this part here?
Collar.
And what's this part here? Cuffs. Okay, and then there's obviously the tie. But look at the symbols of the collar and the cuffs. So who wears a collar and cuffs?
Slaves.
I'm not making that up. That's not hidden, is it?
Hidden in plain sight.
Absolutely. You've got your different grades, blue collar, white collar, dog collar. All your people are known by their collar. So, what I say to people is, to all you seekers and all you activists and all you whatever, is if you've missed that in terms of how obvious that symbology is, where you've been fooled by the context, that's all it is context. Just because it's made of fabric, you've missed it. If you've missed that, what else might you have missed that is just in plain sight? That simple. Not some thing that you have to spend hours poring over law books for to twist your head around somebody else's nonsense. I'm sure that's not what you wanted to come here to do. You know, certainly is what I want to do.
But it wouldn't be conspiracy, it would be outright deception.
Well, it's not a deception, is it? What's the deception of having somebody in a collar and cuffs in front of you? There's no deception there.
Well, because normal people wouldn't think anything of it.
Well, that's only because it's become normalised.
There's a book
by a guy called When I Say No, I Feel Guilty. Okay. I don't know how many of you that relates to. It's a beautiful book. So When I Say No, I Feel Guilty, it's called. And it's about assertiveness. And it was a guy who was brought in to train the Peace Corps after Vietnam. And the young Americans, they found that they were incapable of asserting themselves. And he was trying to work out why. And he was going on about asking people, where were the contracts that you signed that said you would answer any question that was asked of you? He was writing about that back at the tail end of the 60s. But at the beginning of his book, he makes a really powerful point. And he simply says that to him, the worst thing that could happen to a species was that it became domesticated. So the most damaging thing that could happen to a species was domestication, where the infants were all virtually born with their spirits broken, and where they didn't question what was right in front of them. And he was talking about his concern being that the human race was within a hair's breadth of domestication. And I'm highly inclined to agree with him. Because this is what we're up against around us, is this domestication of our not questioning and not having our authority and not feeling a value and a worth in what we bring and what we have to offer. You know, and it's about, and that's what I consider to be the deception, is to do with convincing you incredible, multidimensional, amazing beings that were born in a state of complete self-empowerment and self-love to make you think that what you had to offer was worthless or didn't have value or power or impact. That's the most incredible magical spell ever pulled. And that's what I see as being the benefit of this movement, is that it's an element of healing. You know, there's a bit of mental healing going on in this particular movement, because it's about people starting to feel that empowerment again and starting to feel that sense of authority, and that their actions can make a difference. And that begins with, first of all, realizing that you can turn around and just say no. You know, it's a very simple beginning, and yet most of you are parents will know that, you know, it's the first thing your infant learns is how to say no. It's the most irritating and powerful position there is. Mm-hmm. It really is. It's incredible.
Do you want to go to bed now?
No!
Yeah, exactly. Oh, yeah,
tea time?
Exactly.
No! Exactly. Bath time? No! Yeah.
And what can you do?
Nothing!
Exactly!
No, sin!
Yeah, because the thing is, but this is where the state has to have to reveal themselves, because the only thing there is force. It's all there is. You know? And the rest of it is a veneer. And the thing is, you only have to scratch through a few levels of the veneer to find out that that's what is actually beneath it. Now, I think if you go out of your way to expose bullies and thugs for being bullies and thugs and you find them, then really you have got what you were looking for. And you know, you have to be aware that if that is what you were looking for in this particular game, then that is what you'll find, as Rusty found out, and as Mike and many others have found out, is that you'll find out that they will drag you away, and it's a bit like, na 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 na, we can because we can. You know.
Don't be scared, Tim.
Sorry. It's a long established thing. That's the point. Is that you're right. They know the risks, and the risks for them are minimal.
Exactly.
Yeah, because a well established system. What people don't realise in this movement is that the whole free man thing is simply about a mental position. Because all of this stuff is just up here. All of it. All the control, all the self-censorship, all of it is up here. All the worries that you have over the decisions that you make and all the stuff, it's just here. Your physical body is just sitting on a chair, whether it be at home or at work or whatever. All the rest of it is spinning around here. So that's where they're in their comfort zone, because of basically, you know, magic. Is everybody familiar with the concept that all your words are spells? You know, we spell all our words because all our words are spells. So it's a spell, it's a word or a phrase or a magical effect. And what happens is these things give people special powers.
Yeah, especially when it says, I promise to pay the bill.
That lets them come into your house and steal your property. That lets them come and take your vehicle. That lets them tell you what to do or make demands upon you. And it really is powerful, powerful mental conditioning, because it's paper thin. They're words on a bit of paper. And all of a sudden it makes people behave in crazy ways. Ludicrous conduct from supposedly civilised adult human beings, public servants, all the rest of it. Absolutely ludicrous. It's paper thin magic. Now that is what you are up against in the courtroom, is you are up against somebody else's mental certainty. That a piece of paper is more powerful than yours. And that their 20 years in the job, or whatever it is, you know, their authority. My courtroom, I'll decide the rules in here. Be gone. Oh, you want to try to show that you're some kind of responsible, honourable member of the community? Well, nah, 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 nah. I'm going to do this and chuck a book at you. Because I've seen it happen more and more in recent months. It's made me realise that actually, I feel great compassion for some of our fellow brothers and sisters who have had to go into those venues for 9 to 5 for 20 to 40 years, wearing special robes and hats and all the rest of it, because I think it's twisted a lot of them up here. Okay, I really do. And, you know, we are dealing with forms of, I actually think it's mental illness. You know, that is actually my honest, heartfelt, grounded opinion, is that it's a form of mental illness. It's been normalised. Because paraphrenia
is the diagnosis.
Wow. That's a complex diagnosis, sir. I just like general endemic mental illness myself. Delusions of grandeur and, you know, magical bits of paper.
So the People's Public Trust.
Sorry, yes. Otherwise we'd be at this all night. Yes, People's Public Trust. So the stuff that I've been doing was, I got into all this stuff and my stuff was about title. So I wanted to find out all this stuff about legal fiction, corporation, blah, blah, blah. I'll quickly race through this. My stuff has been about the reclaim of the master title for us in relation to public servants, because when you had the title master, you weren't obliged to comply to statutory requirements. And if you look up the definition of master in any legal or law dictionary, I just leave you to go and do it, and I guarantee you won't find one that says it's got anything to do with being under 16. It's all about you being the employer, about you being the principal and the creditor and all the rest of it. But if you look up the meaning of mister, it's not in any legal dictionary. But the word mystery is, and if you check that out, it's simply defined as a business or a trade. So your mister is your mystery, which is your business or trade name, as it were. Your missus is missing an apostrophe, and it's misters, it means belonging to the business. And your miss, if you picture a form, title, forename, surname, you put miss in title, and it means miss this. Miss is miss this, skip this, no title. Okay, so when women fought for their equal rights, title never caught up. But it didn't matter by that point, the control matrix was already virtually in place. But the point is about the master title in relation to public servants, because master only means one thing. Now, that's been an interesting journey these last few years, but it's led into the creation of the People's Public Trust as an idea. Because, again, this is something I'm not making up. It's just about highlighting what's staring us in the face, just like collar cuff tie. So the point is that everybody's been getting lost in the world of contract. And it's just a maze. Don't delve into it. It doesn't matter, most of it. It's a lot of nonsense. It's just to get you lost. There are layers outside of the statutory and contract jurisdictions which are much more interesting and simple, like trusts. So, before, trust is the fundamental basis of human community. Okay, without trust, you've got nothing. Trust is, you know, without trust, there's no sustainability, there's no reliability, you can't leave your house because, you know, somebody could come and take it. So, trust is the fundamental basis of any of us hanging out together. I trust you not to jump up and stab me with a knife right now. You know, there's all these levels of trust that are going on all the time. Trust is fundamental, it precedes everything else. And that's why they're trying to sideline those away from trusts, because fundamentally, prior to any contractual agreement or prior to anything else, you have a trust relationship with any party. And my position is, for my public servants, they are entrusted to have the well-being of me and my family and my community as the highest personal priority. They are entrusted with providing a safe community and, you know, working for progressive and inclusive and healthy stuff for all of us. And not only are they entrusted with it, they're bloody well paid for it. And we are all mutual beneficiaries of that trust. Now, something interesting about trust law is that you don't need paperwork for a trust. If a trust can be implied or construed, then it exists. That's it, bottom line. I'm not making that up, it's there. That trust is there, they just don't want us to see it. Because in trust jurisdiction, there is no limited liability, which is what they all hide behind in the corporate and statutory jurisdictions. It's what allows them to do what they like without responsibility. Now, the point that I make to many companies is limited liability is a position of diminished responsibility, and that used to only be afforded to children and the mentally ill. Which are you? Okay? Otherwise, step out from behind your filing cabinet, because you are liable for your conduct. And I require and demand a humane and human interaction, please. It's not a lot to ask. Now, the point is, people abandoning their humanity is an endemic thing in the corporate world, because most people don't want to be there. And if that's the case, then go and do something you want to do, as far as I'm concerned. But don't come hassling me. One thing that I've learned in the last year is that as a human being with free will who is both vulnerable and inconsistent, I reserve the right to change my mind at any bloody time I see fit. Do you know what I mean? Corporate entities are not generally vulnerable to us and are generally consistent, which is fine, but I don't expect, you know, I am not answerable to their things. I mean, something I've been invoking a lot recently is my own force majeure, because they've got it in their terms and conditions that, oh yeah, whatever they consider to be an act of divine can allow them to render all terms null and void. Well, I'm sorry, I invoke that clause at any bloody time I see fit. Because the act of the divine is the force of life that moves through me that doesn't move through you, you mental bunch. You know? It's true though, It's like you're just this endless entity. So anyway, my point is that I see a lot of these battles as being very, very large, and I'm a bit of a strategist, and I don't like to waste my energy. So, I don't really want to be taking on multinational, international banks until I cut my teeth a bit first. I don't really want to be delving too much into the, you know, I'm sick fed up of watching people's liberty be deprived on matters like parking tickets and speeding fines. And for me, the deprivation of liberty begins from the first day you have to go to court. And you have to waste your time travelling there, spend a whole bloody day waiting for them to see you, put up with their nonsense and then leave, only to be dissatisfied and to have that happen repeatedly again and again and again. Now, that to me is a deprivation of bloody liberty. And I'm tired of seeing it happen, to be quite honest. Now, the idea of the People's Public Trust is that our relationship with our public servants is first and foremost a trust one. Now, the funny thing is that you cannot have somebody else represent powers you do not have. Okay, can everyone grasp that? So, you can't have somebody represent your bag of apples if you don't have a bag of apples. Does that make sense? Yeah? So that means that you can't... Can I steal a bit of this? Sorry, yeah, I'm making most of it.
This is how he always gets a beer.
I can get another.
No, I wouldn't mind that, because then I'm going to continue to dry up. Where was I there? Pop quiz.
Apples.
Yeah. So, you can't have
somebody
else...
Right, he wants a pint of cider, I think.
You can't have somebody else represent your sovereignty if you're not sovereign. You can't have somebody else represent your... you know, your diplomatic immunity if you don't have diplomatic immunity. You can't have anybody else represent anything if you don't have it in the first place. Now, the thing about representation is that it's not a gift. It's a representation. So, when you have somebody represent your bag of apples, you don't actually give them your bag of apples. They just represent it. So this is what I mean by assuming your authority away. At all times, you're exercising your sovereignty. At all times. Until somebody comes up and objects to it or obstructs it. Now, what I invite you to consider then is how much of that self-censorship is going on right now and all the time with no state representative here or anywhere near you. That's where your sovereignty is challenged, and that's where the real battle is. But then... anyway, I'm not going to digress into that. I realise I'm going off on a tread yet. That's why I thought I had my name there. I'm going to go back to the trust. So, the point is, your public servants are entrusted with all these things. And the great thing is, in trust jurisdiction, there is no limited liability. They're wholly liable. Now, if you believe that that trust has been breached, and there is a breach of trust, then you have a right and a position to act. Now, the People's Public Trust is a private trust vessel that expresses our sovereignty. It's a private thing. It's coming from a private power on the private side of that representation to say, actually, you've breached this trust. And on those grounds, you can't hide. It's you, the individual. And that's how I've dealt with most of my matters, is by actually saying no. So, like, say, for example, just as an example, council tax. So, for me, when the council don't act, my only point of withholding on council tax was, tell me what it's for. Right? Tell me what it's for, and I'll pay you. So, ambulances, blah, 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 all the rest of it, yes, pay for it all. And when they wouldn't pay for the rest, they said, you know, I said, well, what's it for? They said, oh, it's for the county. They said, well, break it down. What's it actually for? Or what I'm telling you. And it basically summed up as, pay up or we're sending the boys round. And I said that to them. I said, well, okay, you're saying pay up or I'm sending the boys round. You're threatening to come and steal stuff from me because you won't answer my question. Now, that's extortion. Now, my position is that I know this nation that employs representatives that supposedly represent me are going and absolutely, you know, they're bombing people. They are killing people, they are deceiving people, and they're doing all this allegedly in my name and with my money, and if you don't tell me what it's for, I can only assume it's for that. Otherwise, tell me. And on those grounds, I withhold payment, sir. You know? Tell me what it's for. And they wouldn't. And they did eventually go away. But only after a lot of wrangling over this. But it was all about re-establishing the position of saying, well, no, I'm sorry, you are my employee. That's it. You're the one in the collar at the moment, not me. And when you're wearing your collar, you're at work. So give bloody good service. And please, a bit of humanity is free. And if you don't want to do that, then maybe you're in the wrong job. So the People's Public Trust as an idea that extends those sort of interactions that I had with my various suppliers was the problem that, you know, I knew of many free men who were adopting many positions. So there were sovereigns and no-names and, you know, Bobs of the family Smiths and all the rest of it. And they all had these lawful positions and lawful remedies. And they were getting steamrolled again and again and again and again. Cheers. So there were, the steamroller was in full effect. And I saw that what was missing was an effective interface. Because you had all these free men saying, well, this is my position. This is how I feel. And the state were going, well, this is our position. We've had it for hundreds of years. And you know that. So what's the script? And the interface was missing. So I started going into court with this ID badge in the clipboard. This my People's Public Trust Master Observer badge. And to watch the psychological effect that it had on people was incredible. And as soon as people are being watched, and they think they're being watched, it's amazing how their conduct changes.
So we could apply that to any court then, couldn't we, really?
That's the point.
Yeah, under any trust.
In fact, if you watch children, you don't... If a kid's being naughty, you don't have to shout at them, you don't have to do anything except look at them so they know you're looking at them.
Exactly. Do you know what that is? That is quantum consciousness. It really is. It's the observer and the observed. As soon as they observe, know they're being observed, their behaviour changes.
Yeah, sure.
And it's astonishing.
The same happens with yourself as well. You don't need to make resolutions about how you're going to be in the future so much better than you are at the moment. All you have to do is see yourself in the moment.
Yeah.
And then do...
That's why they didn't allow video. Yeah.
Of course it is. That's why Norman Scarf got absolutely hammered and got 6 months.
Yeah, we did go and support him at Leeds Jail though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Good. But the point, the thing is, it really is about that observed thing. And this is where the People's Public Trust came from, because it was all about, well, actually, we're watching you. And we're here on the trust side. And to see the change in behaviour as a strategic manoeuvre, it was like, well, this can work. And actually what we started to do was to say, well, the position of the People's Public Trust is that we make a declaration that expresses the trust that we all have in public servants for that those common things, those very, very simple common things. And we look to work with, this isn't us and them, this is us and us. We're all one community. You know, all of us have to wear a collar at some point. And it's fine we do it because we have to, you know, provide or whatever. And that's fair enough. But it's to realise that, okay, we all have a shot at it. Fair do it, but when we do it, we give it good service. And when we don't, we realise we're all mutual beneficiaries of it. Now, the point then is that when that is not delivered, what do you do? So at first, the People's Public Trust was meant to be a buffer for free men, regardless of their position, to simply make sure they were being afforded a lawful remedy and they were being afforded proper process and all the rest of it. What we've learned in the last year of doing that is that the justice system is not interested in an effective interface with any of you. Okay?
Yeah, I think we've all discovered
that. It does not want to know. It monkeys. Okay? They just want to hold on to their position and that's it. Now, I'm not very happy about that. I don't know about you. Now, so what we're looking to do now is to turn the tables. This is one of the other benefits of the People's Public Trust, because we're looking to win public servants on side. Because I've worked in public service for most of my life. I've worked at local government and national level. And I'll tell you what, there are plenty of good public servants out there. There are loads of them. You see them all the time. And they really do want to give good service and blah, 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 and all the rest of it. And that's brilliant. And they also know who the shady ones are, who the immature ones are, who the bullies are, who the unstable ones are. Now, systematically, by being able to tackle each of them for breach of trust, misconduct in public office, misrepresentation, what these things do is, these are specially chosen charges because they allow us to fix the jurisdiction. And all those charges I just named are either trust or common law charges only. Misconduct in public office, for some reason my escape.
26 years, isn't it? Misconduct in public office.
25 years and unlimited fine. Okay. Serious fine. And also, misconduct in public office is for either action or inaction. And all statutes are for one or the other. And it's an incredibly powerful charge that has started to see increasing use. And we need to use it more. Because it's an incredible charge. The threshold for it is currently quite high. and we need to be working hard to reduce it, to lower that threshold, to say, actually, it's quite easy to misconduct yourself in public office, mate. Especially, by the way, some of you have been behaving recently. And so really what we've been trying to do is pick individual candidates to go after, to escalate the concept of the trust. But tonight I want to talk about how each of you could use it as an idea in particular cases, but I would ask you to be most cautious with those in which you choose to apply it to. Because really it is about working for communities. It's not about our individual little petty financial matters or whatever. You should use your own remedies and your own stuff for that. But really the concept of the public trust is something we can all use in relation to our public servants. Because as far as I'm concerned, if we start to get good representatives, then I'm happy with that. Because I'm not, I was never a free man, I was never interested in it. It's a bit bizarre, you know, I shouldn't really be maybe speaking to a free man group about it, because I didn't want to turn my back on infrastructure, because I didn't want to have to reinvent it. You know, I didn't want to have to recreate it. I don't use all the facilities like swimming pools and libraries and all the rest of it, but I'd like people to have, be able to use them. And with the total free man perspective of, if everyone was a free man right here, right now, today, then what would happen to all those things? Who would maintain the roads? Who would do things like that? We have one of the best infrastructures in the world. Your bins get empty just about every week. Okay, they're reducing that, but that can be worked on. And, you know,
you've got the job.
Sorry?
You've got the job.
Cheers. Oh, great. I need a job at the moment.
Job's got one.
I'm for hire. Mm. But, no, so I'm making light of it, but it is something that, that a lot of thought has gone into. There's been a lot of meetings, a lot of court cases, a lot of various things that have led to the position that we're at. And myself and a number of other people that I work with around the country have come to the conclusion that the only way forward is representative actions, where we no longer deal with our own individual petty matters, because all it does is drain us. It saps us time and energy. And for me, when it comes to your individual petty matter, you know, our individual matters, our individual challenges in our lives, for us, for me it's about your internal state, okay? So it's about how you feel on a daily basis. You know, and anything that affects your state of peace and well-being, that means that you're, you know, it's getting to you basically. And for me, the victory is when it no longer affects you, when these little magic pieces of paper drop through the door. And when it doesn't shift your internal state, when you read that red letter and oh, the notice and all the threats and oh my goodness me, you know. That's the victory, is when that no longer affects you. Time's there. What more do you want? You want the whole world to every individual to capitulate to your whim. No, the victory ends with you maintaining your internal state in that respect. But we obviously have to change the way things are operating, and that's where myself, and I don't know if you know Michael Bernicia, many of you, who was quite one of the
was he there on Thursday?
Yeah, he was there on Thursday. He's freethepanet.net, I highly recommend his website. There's a lot of good stuff on there.
What's his website?
Freethepanet.net.
Yeah, freethepanet.net.
Yeah. There's a lot of good paperwork on there, but he's leading a representative action on mortgage fraud. And what I'm interested in doing with the People's Public Trust is two major misrepresentation and other cases, because I believe that we have to start going for the big issues, because otherwise we're going to be at this forever. You know, let's forget about the little stuff. Use that as the tool to feel our sense of empowerment and authority and get that sense back. But then let's start to make some change and do something. And representative action is the way to do it now, because that's when the steamroller is annulled. Because we've found that they've already tried to discredit the People's Public Trust as an idea, and we've not even done anything. It's laughable. I've done no promotion, I've done nothing, I've just done a few talks in a year, because I didn't want to promote the master stuff, because there was too much anger and emotion in the movement, when this is a mental game, you know? It's a total mental game where you're up against other people's mental convictions. And it's, you know, that made me laugh when I started to get these calls saying, oh, back off on the PPT stuff, try to discredit. Blah, 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 all this sort of stuff. But I'm like, nothing. This is brilliant. Because it speaks for itself, really. So my invitation to people is to both use the People's Public Trust as a concept, because you all have placed your trust in public servants for one thing or another. And you at all times can then turn around and act in that capacity. But I would invite you all to not do it for yourself, to always do it for somebody else. But it's the only way it can work. It is the only way it can work. And this is where we cross over and we cover each other. And it takes the emotional sting out of it when you're doing it for somebody else. That emotional content isn't quite so there. And that is needed. That's the whole point of representation in that arena. Because if it's your issues, then of course you're a bit vulnerable and a bit fragile. We all are. you know what I mean? You're not going to be at your best in there.
You're losing that fear factor if you go in there for somebody else.
Absolutely, and that allows you to cut your teeth to the extent where you can then go in by yourself and stand on your own 2 feet.
You perform to 100% of you. Not affecting you because it's not yourself. You have to go stand on four.
Absolutely, but we'd invite everybody to consider that this whole road is actually part of the journey to self-mastery. So it is about you being able to hold your internal state in the face of whatever is before you and whoever is before you. And that's what sovereignty is. Your jurisdiction is your world, is your reality. And for you to be able to feel that unshakable and unshaken at all times, that is your sovereignty. That is your divine mandate. And I guarantee you that none of us in this room or even on these lands actually is in that position at the moment. But we're on the way. You know, and it's about realizing that. But I believe and see that the only way to take the next steps in this particular avenue is for us to start to do it together. Because the steamroller will be in effect. They've shown it. And there's been a change in the last few months. Just in the last six to eight weeks, there's been a massive change in what I've been hearing on the grapevine for what's happening in court cases. Because up until now, people's paperwork was at least being looked at. It's virtually being completely and utterly ignored now. The steamroller has moved in to fourth gear. I guarantee you most of your paperwork's not even being looked at now. And I told you about all this language stuff and that's what I'm interested in and blah, blah, blah. And one of the funny things is, I was getting involved in a land access case for a family, and basically the long and short of it was that I wrote to the chief constable about who should the community turn to if their public servants have turned upon them, you know, and aren't listening, and you know, if you're not getting dialogue from the council and they're threatening to steal your home or do things like that, who can you turn to? If the police aren't giving you a crime reference number, what are you meant to do? And I got this one line reply that basically said, we have forwarded your letter to the Criminal Justice Department to reply to. Now, we've never had a reply, but I pondered on that and I suddenly realised that was the answer. It's criminal justice. It's justice that is allowed to be criminal in its execution. And that is what we have been living under for the last decade, is criminal justice. And the criminal justice system is lawlessness. It's where they are allowed to break the law, or the so-called law, they're allowed to break the statute in their exercise of the statute upon you. Now, that's where, so for example, the police are allowed to break the speed limit to come to you for whatever, you know, no matter what it is. Now, even in a matter of not personal safety sort of thing, even for petty matters, which really shouldn't be the case, but that's just one minor example of the lawlessness that they're allowed to exert upon you. And there's many, many ways that it can manifest. I'm not here to really list them tonight. But, you know, I just invite you to consider that criminal justice thing, because that really is what we are up against here. We are faced with a criminal justice system, and it's telling us that's what it is. It's honest about it. It's criminal justice. So let's stop trying to take it on personally. Now, there's a few interesting cases that I have in mind that I think would have the necessary oomph to make a bit of a difference, because I believe there's only a few cases of misconduct, misrepresentation, and all the rest of it that we have to take before there would be a landslide change in behaviour from our public servants. Because that's the only position I'm coming from. I'm not interested in anything else. I consider that if we can fix public service, then actually, on our little island in the corner of the universe, then we can do what Iceland did, and that is tell the private banks and everybody else to bugger off.
Anyway.
Because that is what they did, and that's why you don't hear about what's happening there anymore. And so the first misrepresentation case I invite this nation to take is one of, you know, that decision. It said that you and your family and your kids would take on the liability of private bankers for their playboy's mistakes. Did you feel that actually represented your position?
No.
Anyone?
No.
Anyone?
No.
Anyone out there, and you know, through the camera, anyone who watches this? If you feel that represented your position, then please get in touch, because I'll tell you what, I've never met anybody who felt like that represented their position. Doesn't that scream out for a misrepresentation case? Excuse me? Is it about time we started to take some of these so-called public servants to account? Because I have to say, they are clearly not acting with the well-being of the community as their highest personal priority. Yeah. And I've had enough of that. But I know for a fact that to go after some of those big ones, we do need to act together. We need to be able to act in your name. You know, we need you to help in taking that sort of an action, because that is a serious class action. Now, if they're claiming to represent the nation, we need a fair few to say, actually, do you know what? That didn't represent me. Because what was really interesting was the Icelandic nation turned around and said, excuse me, the Icelandic people will not accept liability for your private banker's debts. Thank you very much. and we virtual news blackout for the rest of us. Because, you know, sanctions, you know, they were starving for a while because the Japanese and the Brits weren't letting tankers unload at the bloody shores over all this nonsense of fake money and fake debts and rubbish. Absolute nonsense. Now all these cuts, I mean, there's so many involved in this coalition against the cuts. It's like, why are you protesting the cuts? And the issue isn't the cuts.
What cuts?
The issue is, why is the financial value of this nation not being spent on the people anymore? Because the cuts are not in spending, the cuts are in public spending, i.e. spending on the public. Now excuse me, every single penny of that, as far as I'm concerned, is for spending on our public. And fake interest and fake debts to non-existing creditors that don't exist are what is causing us no end of a problem. And if we can simply find out the individual that signed the piece of paper and say, excuse me, that was misrepresentation, pal, we're not standing under that. Do you know how much that would change overnight? Mm-hmm. And that is simple. Japan and America backed out of the jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court. They said, do you know what, we're not going to deport any of our people to you anymore. And yeah, those people that signed that treaty, we don't actually agree with them anymore, they didn't represent our position. So if they can do that, and the Icelandics can do that, can't we piece those two things together and say, actually, as a nation, whoever did that, they're sacked. Sacked! And in fact, you can never work in public service again. You're an absolute twat, you're clearly sold out to some corporate interest, and I'm sorry, you know, go to some penance somewhere, I'm afraid. You are sacked, mate. I don't think that's, you know, if you got that sort of quality service from your phone provider or your IT provider or something like that, you'd sack them, wouldn't you? It's about time we started trying to serve that, sorry?
You're fired,
absolutely. Mm-hmm. So that is one of them. You know, it's one of the cases that I have in mind. It's not a big issue, I don't think. I think it's quite simple and quite clean cut. And this isn't an us and them thing. This isn't about the abandonment of whatever. This is simply about saying, give it to your representatives. Can you imagine the difference if we could actually start to get representatives that represented us? Quite simply. And I think we only need cases like that. Sorry?
It's a novel approach.
Absolutely. So, yeah, absolutely, absolutely. And that's really my goal with the concept of the People's Public Trust is initially is simply to fix public service for those goals. And I think there's only a few cases that need to be taken before we start to see massive change. Because every single person in the public service is a human being. Some of them just choose to leave their humanity at home because they've sold out to corporate interest, selfish greed, insecurity, inadequacy, ineptness, instability. The list goes on because many of them are affected by all of those things, as are many people in other working environments. But the point is, I'm sorry, they're in the wrong job. The point, go and work for some private company, something like that. Don't be in charge of decisions that affect our communities and our children and our services. Thank you. So that's the sort of goal, yes.
So to sum up,
yes, sum
so
up,
that we can get some drinks for the people and keep
they want to go to bed.
What are the sites that we all need to do and what is the action that we all need to take?
Well, this is a very good point. So the website is peoplespublictrust.com. It's a draft because we haven't actually launched it yet. Please, what we would like is to be able to use your name if that's okay. And if you have time or resource or whatever that you would like to share to help in spreading the word about you know, taking this action, because it can happen as soon as there's enough people on board. I'd like to see it happen by spring, you know, and a few other actions as well. But we also need people to finance the work because, you know, if people can't feed their families and all the rest of it, it means they have to work, and it means then they can't be drawing up all the court paperwork and doing all the necessary stuff. So people's finances to help fund the court. So people who don't have the time can maybe put some money into it, or people who have the time can put their bloody time into it, because really, this is something for all of us. Yes, hand at the back.
Your signature pays for everything. Money is the illusion.
Absolutely. And the point is not just your signature, the government is acting in your name. In your name. And so what I would like is for people to allow and empower the People's Public Trust to also act in your name with that same level of power and authority that is imbued there. And if not just in your name, then as yourself.
For a forensic audit on your own name. Why don't you ask HMRC for a forensic audit on your own name? Are you not the beneficiary of your own name? How much is it making via the stock exchange?
You can go down that route if you like to. See, this is all the personal side of stuff. That's to do with the personal empowerment stuff as far as I'm concerned.
This is a national, international thing.
Yeah.
Where you're traded as livestock on the New York Stock Exchange.
Yeah. See, the thing for me is, right, I've had enough of all of that stuff. I've had enough of going down that wormhole and sheriffs and executors and blah, blah, blah. That's somebody else's world. This year, that I have seen incredible change this year in people's lives. I have seen condensing and manifestation like I've never seen before. And what it has shown and revealed to me more than anything else is, you better be bloody careful about whose thoughts you're reciting in your head. Whose vision are you repeating? Whose world are you reinforcing with your divine thoughts and your time? And this is the one danger with all this alternative media and all this stuff is, if you keep repeating somebody else's world, then that's the world you live in. I've had enough of that. There's no powers that be in my world. It's the powers that were. That is my reality. They're the powers that were. There's some small machination that I occasionally encounter briefly. But other than that, they do not impact my life. And that is the way I continue to work it because of, that is the way I've made it in my mental world. Because that is your reality, is what you repeat. And I invite you to consider that in these times of incredible manifestation, perhaps you should change whose vision you are repeating and how much of your time and your headspace you want to put into this stuff. Because I've had enough. Yes, it's interesting. Yes, there's knowledge. Yes, there's interesting revelation. But you can choose when you want to back out of that particular rabbit hole and realize that it leads nowhere. Because it's a really interesting thing. We are bombarded with more information than we've ever been subject to, ever, in all avenues, on all levels. And the question is, it's not about truth. It's about importance and relevance. Okay, because you can find truth 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and never run out. You can find countless YouTube videos and web pages filled with truth. But how much of it is important? How much of it is going to take me somewhere? How much of it is bloody relevant? Because I'll tell you what, you're looking at far fewer that actually lead somewhere. And that's what I'm interested in now. And I mean, I don't mind, if this is what I mean about people's personal positions. You go and research whatever you like, go and enjoy whatever avenue, because that's part of this great thing that is being the human race, is that each of you will explore things that I don't want to and I'll do stuff you don't want to. That's our diversity, it's brilliant. What we're talking about here is our common services and our common infrastructure and all that sort of stuff. And that's what I'm interested in, because no matter how I want to live my life, I want to make sure, like you said, that the family, my children, have a safe environment and don't have to be brought up with, you know, with me being concerned about the images and the ideas they're going to be surrounded by. That's what I'm interested in. I actually don't give a crap about the rest of it. It's not my world. It's not my reality. It's not my language. I'm not in the law society. I'm not interested in their interpretation of language and English. I do my own stuff on that. It's much more interesting to me. And this is what I mean about you all getting a sense of how your sovereignty is compromised by how much credit you give to that ideology and how much credit you give to those arenas and those venues and those people. Because that's where it's being taken away from you. That's where you assume it away every day. And so in these incredible times and with this vast change that is upon us, I invite you to consider, what do you want? And maybe start repeating that in your head and picturing that. And yes, use this stuff, but only to that position where you feel empowered. And after that, the victory ends. You don't need to have that day in court. You don't need the letter with a zero balance. That's irrelevant. It's irrelevant nonsense. But if you want to help evoke some change in other people's worlds and in general life, I actually think the People's Public Trust is a vessel that could work for all of us and that you can all use it. So, yes, website, you can register on there, that would be great. You can email on there as well. You can email me at darren@peoplespublictrust.com. I don't know what else to say, really. That's really my position is, I don't want to spend my time on any more of these petty matters because it's sapping us all. I want to just focus on the big issues, let's nail it, let's do something that can actually make a difference. And I think these particular strategies, Michael Benicia with his mortgage fraud claim, so I want to repeat that, that's very powerful. Any of you who have got mortgages, get in touch with Michael, freetheplanet.net. And if you're interested in helping fix the public service, then, you know, get in touch with peoplespublictrust.com. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Darren.
Thank you.
Quick and a follow of that. It was very erudite and informed. I've been working for this for about 18 months, 2 years now. I decided from the start not to get involved with the middlemen, the courts. Can everyone hear me okay? Yeah?
Yeah.
Not to get involved with the courts or the police, or just go for the head, go for the tail, as I said a couple months and months ago. Daryl last October had done a talk, and he said something which just stayed with me, and he said when you finish doing your own journey of discovery, you'll end up knowing the answers. Trusts. Correct. Mm-hmm. Absolutely correct. Right? I've been there, looked at everything, it's trust, right? And I'm looking at what other people, you're getting Dean Cliffords and, you know, Winston Shrouds, people from all over the world are all through their own weaving, their own path, are coming to the answer, the solution to the answer is understanding trusts. And only understanding the trusts is using the trusts. Now, we were talking our group last week, and there's like three phases. First phase is awakening, is we learn enough information to realise that something's badly, badly wrong, yeah? Second phase is where you learn enough knowledge to say, stop hurting me, stop hitting me, like the big bully in school, stop hitting me. The third phase, we start going for the bastards, and I mean that in the real sense of the word. We go for them, we start taking the offensive, now we can do it. There's enough of us, we've got enough information, the pool of brains in this room is it's quite incredible what we can achieve as people. Lawfully, peacefully, and start going for them. Now, Daryl's approach with, Daryl's public sector, I come from private sector, so maybe slightly different approaches. With Daryl's very sort of passive, you know, everybody's lovely and let's deal with them.
I'm private sector.
Go for the throat. They've hurt me, I'll hurt them back, right? Legally and lawfully, without, you know, no violence or anything. But somebody wants to take on my business, I'll crush them. It's as simple as that, yeah? There's finding the tools of how we can fight back. There's a saying, the reason why I was so interested in what Darren was saying is because...
Darren, sorry,
I do apologise, Darren. Thanks for taking me there, mate, much appreciated. Is that
awkward accent to you?
If you talk to authorities, you write letters, as Darren was saying, you write these beautiful letters, you spend hours sculpting these masterpiece letters, mm-hmm. you've walked into my trap, got you, then they respond back by sticking two fingers up to you, talking to you like you're a 2-year-old child, and you piss off, you know, and you're like, oh, that's not how, you know, I deserve respect here. And the issue is, guys, as individuals, we are not getting respect as equals. We're getting talked to master servant. Now, I don't actually recall knowingly giving anyone a permission to talk to me like I'm a servant, except those in the army, which was a mistake. I never agreed to anyone becoming my master. And I reserve the right to say, hold on, I don't want you to be my master anymore. And any presumption you have of being my master, I rebut that now. I am my master. I'll be nice to you. I'll play the rules everybody else is playing, I won't hurt anyone, I'll live by the common law of principles, blah 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 blah. And all I ask is you just leave me alone. But they don't leave you alone. You turn your back and they're back in again. More money, we've changed the law, we need more money from you. You've done that, oh, we're going to destroy your life for it, you know. And it's like, enough guys, I've just had enough of you, you know. It's like the school bully. When I was at school as a young lad, you're at a rough school in Scotland, those are bullies. And you try to placate them, and they come back and bully you again. You see, he's an easy target. He tried to be their friends, and they bully you again, easy target. And the first day I turned there, I dropped a bully flat on his arse. I smacked him in the nose. I mean, it was a big step for his young laddie. I took the biggest lad in the school, and I smacked him in the nose, dropped him in his arse. I tell you what, I get respect after that. And that's how we do it, guys. We take on the big guys and go for the individuals. So what I'm proposing is similar idea to what Darren's doing, but a little bit less sort of pleasant.
No,
a bit less sort of understanding as we make examples. We earn our respect. Respect isn't a right, you earn respect, we start earning our right. So from what my own study, my own journey's taken me is that we trusts, right? I've established that you can step back from the birth registry. The peasants trust, the peons trust, whatever you want to call it, the security trust, whatever. You can step back from that because nobody's willing to tell me what it is. I don't know how it works. If you're running a business, for example, anyone in this room, you're running a business. Right, sorry for picking yourself. You're running a business. Somebody says, right, I'm going to give you a business. I'm not going to tell you what the rules. I'm not going to tell you the shareholders are. I'm not going to tell you the formation of the company. I won't even let you know what your role is in the company. Right, sign here for it. Hold you this. Exactly, but we do this every day with our bloody name. We do it every day. Sign here. Yeah, okay. We need to start now. I was on TNS Radio talking on Tuesday night there. It all boils down to private sector, and this is supposed to be public sector as well. Liability. You understand your liability. You start asking, What's my liability by agreeing to that? If I agree to that, who's accepting liability? And it's to do with the trust thing, because the person who's accepting the liability is the guy who's going to get hammered at the end of the day, right? So you need to establish, in this trust, what is my role? Should I be accepting liability for it? No, you shouldn't. Unless you choose to. Unless you, if you understand what you're signing up to, full disclosure, and you understand what you understand everything that's happening here, you understand the repercussions, you understand your liability, because by God, the guys at the top understand the liability, and they run like hell when the liability is getting burned, when the liability is getting breached. You say, no, I'm not saying that because I don't understand my liability. But if you're willing to accept my liability for signing the name, I'm happy to do that. They won't do that, by the way. They won't have tried it, they won't do it. Because I'll throw my mortgage and everything at them if they accept the liability as the name. They're not that stupid. So what I'm proposing is we set up our trust, and I'm looking at a sovereign equity wealth fund, right? We start using the traders. Techniques. That's why they're above the law. Why is no bankers in jail, by the way? Does anyone know that? Because they don't live in this country. They live in the inner city of London, set different jurisdiction. Right. The Queen is no sovereignty in the city of London. They're all protected within trusts, within trusts, within trusts.
That's isn't it?
It's not a theory, it's true.
Yeah,
it's true.
That's why it's treason.
And also they're buried within trusts. The cost of taking them to court. And you see these guys, like you go to court, these bankers and traders and whatever go to court. It takes years and years and years and years and years for the court to see, because it's so complicated. And they'll sit down and say, "Is it worth taking this guy to court? It's going to cost us millions." There's no certain outcome because they bury themselves in trust. We do the same thing. So when you've got your peasant trust, your Security 2 trust, whatever we call it, right? Use that. Carry on using it, guys. You've paid insurance and that. You're due money on it. Carry on using it, right? But when you're not comfortable with the liability of something, you set up your own private and your own public trust to decide about your own one. You're in control of it, you've set it up, you're the boss, you're in charge of it, you set it up, and use that when you need to. This is how companies work. You set up a sub-company of your company, or a separate company, right? It's exactly how you run a business. We then start, if someone in authority gets a bit above themselves, and they're acting as an equal, not acting as our servant, and they're starting to push us, we then look at leaning them, right? We lien them. We will set up campaigns, deliberate campaigns, right? One after, for example, one car with the one person, we get an old banger, person's rights to don't wait, never react. Always we set the battleground, right? You buy the car from someone else, you transfer it to your free man, sovereign, whatever your name, and then you write to DVLA saying, "I have conditional notice on this on. I'm not going to accept this unless you do da 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 da," right? You'll get a letter back from DVLA saying, "We're not, you know, we're going to standard crap letter." You get at that point, you sell the car to someone else, and it goes along the chain, and you end up with a huge chain of liens, one after the other, after the other, after the other. And we can do this in so many different ways. We can just set up chains of liens as a group. Just bang, 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 all in that same one person. And what we do is you can't sell a lien. What you can do is you can transfer the fiduciary duty to a central equity trust fund. I call it a sovereign trust fund because I'm no longer a citizen of this country, I'm no longer a citizen of the UK. I've stood back totally from the name completely. I can stand back whenever I want because this is something we'll talk to later on. But you can separate yourself. There's no proof that you are that name. Can anyone in this room prove to me you're the name? You can't. Trust me. Neither can the judge. Funny, I never go to court, isn't it? Anyway, so that's the first question I'd ask the judge. If I can't prove who I am, because I lay the ground, I don't react, I lay the ground. So my first thing is, I can't prove I am who I am. Can you help me here, guys? The very passive approach. And I throw in at the end of it that this is potentially fraud, deceit, and perjury. Because if they try to take me to court, I say, "Well, judge, can you prove to me who you are?" No, you can't. So, you know. Anyway, long story. Right, so the Sovereign Wealth Trust Fund, we then collect all the liens and acts as a fiduciary agent. And anyone who puts a lien into a trust fund automatically gets a percentage share of that trust fund. There's no money involved in it, it's all paper money, right? You become a benefactor, a trustee, and a part of the board of management. Everybody does. There's nobody in charge of us, it's a group, you know, group decision, board meetings, properly run like a business. And the Equity Trust Fund sends the bill sends notice to the debtor that they're now holding the lien, and they're going to be enforcing the lien. We also set up our own debt collection agency to the side of the Equity Trust Fund, working for the Equity Trust Fund, collecting the liens. We're not doing it at the moment. I was up talking to Scottish Sovereigns as well, and everybody's got their own little liens going on, right? And they're all sitting there on them, and they're doing nothing, right? Collect them into a big pot. When it becomes really, really valuable, start hitting them. Got a coordinated campaign, hitting them. And say, we've got the brains here to do it, guys, we can make it work. You know, hurt them when it hurts. Credit rating. Judges. Policemen, as a policeman told me a few weeks ago there, are all bonded. Where do they get the bond from?
Public liability.
Much does the bond cost?
£1 million.
Right. They've all got insurances, haven't they? Public indemnity insurance, public liability insurance, they've all got their insurances. Much does that cost? All depends what the credit rating is. Let's help the credit rating, guys. Let's go. They do it to us. I'm not inventing anything new here. This is exactly the same crap we get thrown at us. I want to spin it around and throw it back at them. We set up our own debt collection agency with an interesting twist that's from international. I've got contacts from other countries around the world, interesting countries, who are very interested in getting involved in this. We can set this up as an international venture, so thereby muddying the jurisdiction even further. I am non-sovereign, well, I'm non-resident, legally. I'm non-resident in this country, so I'm happy to bring the non-resident element of it. We can all go non-resident. If you actually look at HMRC, their definition of trust, etc., we can set up a non-resident element of the trust as well, and just make it as an absolute nightmare for them to even know who we are, what we're up to, you know. We can do it, and we can start hurting them back, you know. I don't know all the finite details. This is why I'm coming to you guys. The idea's there, it's solid. I've looked at what they throw at us, I want to throw it back, right? I've got a working knowledge of trusts, I've got a working knowledge of liens, I've got, you know.
There is people that have done effective liens.
Absolutely.
Mike Dobson, for a start.
We've got the knowledge out there. We need making board. I'm asking you guys for help here, you know.
Can I just say as well that the interesting thing that people have to realise as well is that this is all about, you know, the private and public element is really significant. And anybody's lien value, or outstanding bills and invoices that are unpaid, they have a private value that is their face value. That is a private side. They are a private asset that, between us, because we can all agree that that does have the value, because we can agree to the validity of your lien.
Yes.
I can say, yeah, absolutely. I agree with that, because absolutely. I can see the trend, and that's what private value is.
Absolutely.
You know? So you immediately, in your own, because this is what we need to do is realise that this isn't about organisation, this is about association.
Mm.
And really, you have your own private family or community trust that already exists. You know, all you're doing is remember, you're not creating anything here. You're recognising what already exists.
Exactly.
Already there. Same with the relationship with judges and all the rest of it. And to realise that with the value of these perfected liens and whatnot, that's you immediately have a trust with a private net value worth whatever you're asking.
Selling numbers. Selling numbers.
There you go, you're immediately.
I'm sitting with DVLA just now with two entity. Black and white liens, £1.2 million each.
Yeah.
Guaranteed, you know. But as an individual, I can't enforce that. We can as a group.
Yeah,
two questions about that. Yeah, first is what, how will we be expected to go into it? Are we the trustees or are we the beneficiaries?
Both.
We're not the trustees, we're the executor beneficiary.
Yeah, you can't be the trustee and the beneficiary, because it won't be a trust.
No, the general executor and the beneficiary.
So who is the trustees?
A common law trust, you must have an intent.
Civil servant is a trustee.
Yeah, but who in this trust in particular, who's going to be the trustees?
Anyone you want.
The trustees have the responsibility of the
trust. Right, the benefactor can be anything we want. We can set up as a separate trust to the benefactors. All the liens go into, all the people put the liens in perform at trust, right? The trustees are a board of management like a company. Right. The trustees are, everybody who's put the liens in becomes automatically the board of management.
Sorry.
Trustee, beneficiary, and executor. Yeah.
The executor is the mind. The mind
is the board of management, yeah.
Trustee what to do.
Yeah.
And your spirit benefits as a whole.
Yeah. Okay, right.
Nice.
Anyway, I'll talk from a business point of view.
Like
the benefactors are shareholders, right? We are the shareholders, right? can be a group of shareholders, right? It doesn't have to be one person, but a group of shareholders, right? The board of management, the executor, is us making decisions as board of directors, and the trustees are the people who are enforced or bringing the money in and putting the money out, right? So they're employees. And we'll keep it running like a small business. Just keep it simple, yeah, small business.
In the last week, I've had two sorts of plans.
Yeah, yeah.
And both have mentioned foreign interest countries coming in. I'd like to know a little bit more definition on what part are they playing, what are they bringing to the table, right. What responsibility.
All that does is, this is exactly what we're looking at, is how the big guys do it, right? They bring in the foreign jurisdiction side of it. Mm. I've been doing a lot of reading on, brain's going
no,
dead.
No, I think the point here, the way is, what Lockie's point, I think, is about responsibility and accountability, because that still exists within a trust.
Yes.
It's like, well, okay, what am I accountable for? Because this is something that, there's quite a number of groups that are quite far down the road on this, and you do come up against the issue of trust.
Yeah.
That's the point.
Yeah.
Like, who do you trust?
I'm thinking these foreign countries that are coming in are going to be poor countries, third world countries. What are they bringing into it?
No.
What are they expecting back from it?
Right, we can build it, we can have. So on the board of management, right, there won't be any men on the board of management, right? The men will form a trust, and when I say men, I mean men and women, right? Men and women will form a trust, so the board of management will be trusts. You can build it within trust as well. Build it a veil of cooperation.
Yeah.
A veil of cooperation is where, if you want to ask who's making the decisions at the end of the day, you can't find who owns the company. You've seen this with these dodgy...
It's layering
the trust in, right? So if they come for us, it's so impossibly expensive to even engage in conversation, they won't even bother. This is how the big guys do it. We just throw it back, you know. The foreign thing, we don't need to go the foreign thing, because we can stay non-resident in the UK and argue the fact that we're sovereigns, therefore we're non-resident.
Yeah, well, I'm a great believer that we need to clean his own backyard.
Yeah, the reason we bring in foreign, as I said on the board of management, on the beneficiaries, we bring in people from, I've got a friend in a pit here in Ireland, for example, that's the arse end of nowhere. I mean, it's right in the middle of the Pacific, there's 40 people in Ireland, right? I've got a very good friend who's well on board with this. He's willing to come on board. So we, if they want to talk to us, they're not talking to all, British servants. They're talking to people who come in from all over the world. So we've got Mexicans we can bring in, Germans, Russians, who are not under British jurisdiction,
to me, the only question there is, and it really is the only question, is jurisdiction.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's
the only question. Why even in my world? What do you say to me? What's this nonsense you're spurting?
Make it
me?
As muddy
get
as possible.
Get out of my face, do you know what I mean?
Sweet.
But the jurisdiction point is, like you say, not everybody can make the connections that you're talking about.
Yeah.
But what not a lot of people know is, the jurisdiction is portable, and you can create it any time.
Yeah.
Because if you look at embassies in each country, whose jurisdiction is that the embassy? Yeah. It's the jurisdiction of the nation, it's not tied to the land. Now, there's really interesting stuff to do with jurisdictions in the UK, especially to do with in Scotland, because in Scotland the titles are allodial.
That's right.
Now, what that means is they're not actually truly Crown Estate. Now, apparently this is all to do with Mary Queen of Scots being Queen of Scots and not of Scotland, and it's always been that way, but I'm not absolutely sure if it was that, or whether it's to do with devolution in 2000.
Well, the Queen is Queen of England, she's Queen of Scots, she doesn't own the land in Scotland.
Exactly. So the point is, when you've got any piece of land there, you have your own self-creatable jurisdiction that is portable at any time. But the whole point is do you conduct yourself honourably in displaying the fact that you carry your jurisdiction with you? Do you have your flag on your vehicle? Is your land fenced off? Do you have a flag and you are now leaving the EU? You are now entering the EU signs? Do you perhaps have a little booth at the corner of your land that says, open on, 1-3 one day a year for passport control.
Yeah.
What do you do to declare?
We can play with things this. We can play. There's a whole raft of things we can do and have a bit of fun with this, And we can say, trust within trust.
But I think you should do it that way.
Make it as muddy and as inter-jurisdictional and as complicated and as hidden as we possibly can. So even to talk to us. A magistrate's court is a commercial enterprise. If it's going to work at a loss, for them to take each one of us to court for some stupid, won't bother, simple equation, business.
Well, I think when we talk about trust, that the trust is exactly what it says it is. It's a trust.
It's a trust.
So you have to trust in the next person. The
That's
next
right.
Person, or whatever.
This trust,
I think both of you have come tonight with good ideas and good intentions. And I'm just thinking, oh, can you two not, like,
yes, get just, together? We just done it, didn't it?
and then come back with something, like a presentation that, or something I can sign up for.
Yeah. Well, baby steps first. We'll go baby steps first. There's nothing to sign up for. There's no liability in this. It's just paper numbers, right? There's no liability. But the next stage is after the baby steps is we try and protect ourselves. Now, there was a chap on the BBC last week, some financier, right, some trader, he was talking about, you know, protecting ourselves. You've all seen it. You've all seen it. And he said, correct. First thing you do is protect your assets, right? We set up a trust and we set it up as a template for everybody to copy, mortgage, everything. Dump everything you can into this trust and protect it within a separate trust. Get out of the state trust, get your own private trust. We've got to do it, guys. Because trust me, all these trust babies are born, that's what happens to them. Everything, they own nothing, everything's dumped into trust, it's untouchable then. We have to protect ourselves if this economy crashes, guys. I think we're getting everyone in trust, right?
And just in general.
We will try, and I want to make this as simple as it's too complicated people won't do it. It has to be simple answer, right? We set up templates. We test it, prove it, and people follow behind and copy the template. It's, you know, keep it as simple. You don't need to become an expert in bloody trust law because it blows the mind, you know. Just keep following templates and just copy what other people are doing and protect your assets, guys. Because trust me, if the economy was the crap, we're going to come for us, you know.
You need to come under the umbrella of one bench or something.
One group of trusts. The other aspect, an interesting aspect from the free man point of view, a sovereign point of view, right, is this is what we're looking at is unregistered common law private trusts as the main vehicle. We use public trusts as well, but they'll be the main vehicle. Where was it going there? Sorry, the brain freeze.
Public trust.
Can you say that the public trust isn't a public trust, it's a private trust?
Yes, absolutely, yes. Yes. I've been educated.
It's expression right. of a public
I'm
trust.
I'm learning, guys. We're all learning.
Sorry,
I'm learning.
That was
I'm
just
learning.
Jumping here again.
This is why I've been trying to hold this guy from with me, because I knew I was so close and he could save me a lot of headaches reading. Because you pick up a trust book and it's like, it's, trust me. The trusts. To bring in the common law, these are common law trusts, right? We claim common law jurisdiction on them as sovereigns, right? What we do is we have, in every trust, we can have trust within trust within trust. We build up a network of trusts, and each trust with a minimum of 15 people in a trust, I would put on the table at the moment, right?
By a wall of trusts.
And by doing that, we are forming every trust as its own common law court. How good is that? Every trust has its own common law court, so you've got your prosecutor, you've got your defender, you've got your jury, and potentially a judge, and bring a judge in for another trust to sit in it. We build up our own trust. In every trust, we have a man of God. I'm a man of God, believe it or not, I'm actually a registered minister.
I thought you were a Jedi.
Yeah, I am. Right, I'm a non-believer minister, right? But I'm a man of God, right? So we claim the same jurisdiction as them. And we can have fun and games with this guy, you know, we can genuinely have fun and games. All we need is one guy who's a man of God to join each trust, and you've got that's giving you the same standing as any court in this land. You know, it needs thought through, it needs more planning, it needs more tweaking, it needs a lot more input from people who've done a lot more. I've used the shotgun approach. I know it's right. All I need now is just to tweak it and get it up and running. So I'm looking for guys is forming, you know, a really good team here. We can get together and get this thing driving forward, and gain the respect, earn the respect, not just ask for it, which we're doing at the moment. So please give me some respect. If you don't give me respect, I'm going to make your life very unpleasant, you know. That's how you get respect. So we're focused on. We've got our individual groups, and all helping each other, and there's a few people in the chat, and we're trying to bail them out, one thing or another. But what we do is just focus on the trust thing, because this is the key, guys. If we do this, we get the respect. And by God, if they don't respect us, we'll bring them down one at a time. All you do is pick one person who is an arrogant little crapper, little shit, you know. We take him on, her on, and we bring them down. When we hurt them, we bring them down and say, next. How scary is that? That's the private sector doing things.
Yeah.
That's scary. All you do is do one person.
Believe me, no, when you go into court, because I've done it with Mark Dobson, into magistrates court, and we were from the West Lane Community Trust, the trust that we're doing, and as soon as you mention the word trust,
yeah.
Completely different
yeah.
people.
Yeah.
They're apologetic, they yeah. won't get kind of it's illegal, but I'm sorry to keep you waiting, blah blah blah, this, that, blah, blah. They just roll over. Just the word trust, because it's been indoctrinated into them to respect that word.
Yeah.
Yeah? Yeah. The masters have come and said, anyone says trust, you respect it. Yeah?
So
we're using the word trust, and it They were using the master's words.
Absolutely. So if we use that for Rusty's case on Friday and go in, like me and Darren were talking about outside, and put a public trust observer in every court.
Yes.
You know, we're not just going to do the one court, are we? We can do the whole courthouse, one in every room.
That's the point. That is the point.
And not only that, while you're observing, you're learning.
No, the best thing about it is no one has to say anything.
That's good. That's good.
Just a pair of eyes.
That lets them know we're watching. Mm. We need to just keep it talking to them. The debt collection thing is the key to it.
Clipboard and a badge now,
we're sorting badges and clipboards, aren't we?
Yeah, I'd love to have somebody who's actually been a debt collector in the past. Because we will do it through statute. If we have to liaise, mate, we have to do the liaise, We'll get a set up.
Don't want the same work, mate.
I'm happy to debt collect. Because if I'm not a debt collector, some little granny who can't afford to pay council taxes and fund some bloody illegal war, I can collect that. But if you ask me to collect against some bloody council flunky who can pay £250,000 a year to sit in their arse and treat me like a servant, I'll go for him or her all
the time. Tony Blair's worth lodging a few liens against her. You make quite a bit of money out of that.
I would suggest it's all to do with private public trust as well.
With promissory notes, we'd accept them if they weren't. So according to the Bill of Exchange Act 1882, why can't we take a signature from them and then monetize it? We've got a big trust in place.
Why not?
We'll monetize that.
So if you want your lien, it's your lien. If you want your lien paid in promissory notes, you ask for promissory notes. If someone wants paid in silver, they ask for, it's up to you what you want, paid.
Do it's your lien. Form and handle promissory notes.
You have to lodge it with the courts to bring it from the private sector into the public.
Yes, that's why.
So you might as well use their bailiffs to draw and draw it for you.
Absolutely.
And you have to put it through them to bring it from the private into the public.
Yeah. But this is where the international debt collection thing becomes very, very scary because you can use different jurisdictions to collect on. Yeah. And this is where it gets interesting. Yeah. But, that's...
We've been offered of late from foreign countries and that. They've offered to pay any liens at all. They'll give a penny in the pound for it.
How scary is that? If you're a judge, they can have nothing against judges. I mean, most judges are in there just doing a cold job, right? They put the hat on, they put the personality on side, they go in there and just doing a cold job, right? Love them, hate them, that's what they do, right? But that judge gets a letter, he gets leaned, right? You go through the proper process, following the procedures we set up, or people set up, we copy them, templates, and he gets his lien, and he goes, just ignoring that. And 3 weeks later, he gets a letter from a sovereign equity trust fund, right, with two or three trading addresses, one being Pitcairn Islands, another one being Mexico, another one being Baghdad, and another one in Manchester, right? Saying we now have fiduciary rights over your lien.
Assets.
Can we do a deal here? Now, that would, I don't know, that would frighten the crap out of me if I woke up and I went through that my door, Baghdad, Mexico, and fucking wherever, Kid North Korea, whatever, that would scare them. That's how we do it, guys, And I would suggest the debt collection. We can do the local debt collection, but international debt collection is terrifying because you can use jurisdiction for another country to go for them. So that means if they leave out, if a certain individual goes to another country, right, we can grab them under a different jurisdiction. And we can work with other sovereigns from around the world to enforce this, right?
The only problem I have that one, I think, is I'm trying to look into it, is to think, are we increasing our national debt with them? Or are they decreasing it with us? And if all this is debt anyway,
it's not debt, it's equity. Equity. It's not debt, it's equity we're after.
What is this debt? What is this debt? What is it? It's just an idea.
It's just a number.
It's just
a number that one country owes another.
Yeah. No, we don't owe anything.
No, we don't. The country does.
We don't owe anything. What is it?
540% GDP I think we're at the moment in this country.
I think it was you at the stockport rate about a year ago that a lad from who was coming to the stockport rate, I can't even remember who he was now, produced a thing from HM Treasurer. Actually stating that nobody in this country was in debt. The only thing in this country was in debt was the government.
The board of management. The board of management. The crown and the crown.